Assalamu alaikum, dear students. Welcome to the YouTube channel of Multan Public School and College for Boys and Girls. And also welcome to O Level 10 in your Biology class 5090 in lecture number 5. Today we will study about chapter 18, Ecology, its second part. Hopefully you people have learned all the definitions that we studied in the part 1, because each and every definition is related with each other. Before going into the main topics of the chapter, let's study about the learning objectives of part 2 of ecology. By the end of this video, you should be able to state the non-cyclic nature of energy flow. Dear students, before going into the main topics of the chapter, let's study the learning objectives of this topic. By the end of this video, you should be able to state the non-cyclic nature of energy flow, and then you should be able to define the terms producer, consumer, herbivore, carnivore, food chain and food web, and describe energy losses between trophic levels and infer advantages of shorter food chains. And you should also be able to describe and interpret pyramids of number, pyramids of energy and pyramids of biomass. Dear students, now let's study the non-cyclic energy flow in an ecosystem. You know that the sun, which is the main source of energy on planet Earth, the light energy of the sun is used by the green plants, which are the producers. They convert this light energy into chemical energy by the process of photosynthesis. Now these producers, they are eaten up by the primary consumers, which are the herbivores. That is the sun. Then these primary consumers, that is the herbivores, are eaten up by carnivores, for example lion, cat, dog, a crocodile, a snake or any other carnivore. So that is a secondary consumer. So we see that food is transferred from the producers to the primary consumers and then to the secondary consumers. But you see that the energy is not transferred in a cyclic way. The producers, they are not giving 100% to the primary consumers, because whatever energy they are receiving from the sun, that is the light energy, some of the energy is wasted into the environments when the plants respire. Also, heat is lost to the environment. Only some energy remains within the plants, which it utilizes to make its protoplasm. Then that energy is converted into the herbivore energy. So that herbivore also wastes some of the energy as respiration. Some of the energy is lost into the environment as heat. And when the animal, that is the herbivore, either excretes or the undigested food material is digested out from the body, again energy is lost. Similarly, the carnivores, that is the secondary consumers, they also respire, so heat is lost into the environment. Plus, carbon dioxide is also given out. This is the carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide remains into the environment. When these secondary consumers, they excrete and they digest out the undigested food material plus their dead bodies, because all parts are not eaten up by the carnivores. Similarly, all parts of the plants are not eaten up by herbivores. They all are decomposed by bacteria and fungi, Again, heat energy is released into the environment and some carbon dioxide is produced. This carbon dioxide is used by the green plants in photosynthesis. Now let's study what is a food chain. A food chain is a series of organisms through which energy is transferred. Now you see, we are always talking about energy in the case of ecology. That energy is transferred in the form of food. Even though that the animals are eating food, but we say that energy is transferred from one organism to another. Now let's study some food chains. For example, grass eaten up by rabbit. Rabbit is in turn eaten by snake. If we see another example of the aquatic environment like water plant, it may be eaten up a tadpole. I hope all of you remember what is a tadpole. Good. These tadpoles are eaten up by dragonfly nymph. And the dragonfly nymphs are eaten up by frogs. So now you see that each stage in a food chain is known as trophic level. It means that the grass is first trophic level, rabbit is second trophic level, and snake is third trophic level. Similarly, in the second food chain, water plant is first trophic level, tadpole is second, dragonfly nymph is third, and frog is fourth trophic level. Now, in the case of food chains, as we know that the energy is lost in every trophic level. So less and less energy is available for the organisms at the next level as we go down in the food chain. So food chains are generally short. A shorter food chain means that more energy is available to the final consumer because less energy is lost to the environment. So we say that the shorter food chains are more efficient than long food chains. A shorter food chain means more energy is available to the final consumer because less energy is lost to the environment. We say that the shorter food chains are more efficient than long food chain. It means that if we eat plants rather than other primary consumers, for example, the goat or the chicken, so we will be getting more energy. Hopefully you have understood this thing. Okay, now let's see some another examples. If we study and talk about a terrestrial food chain, the primary producers are the plants. The primary consumers, they may be the grasshoppers. A secondary consumer may be a rat or a mouse, which are eating up these grasshoppers. The tertiary consumers may be the carnivores, which are the snakes. Then the quaternary consumer may be a hawk, which in turn again eats the snake. Now let's talk about a marine food chain. Have you ever thought that why marine food chains we have to study? Oh yes. 75% of the planet Earth is marine. There are seas and oceans. So the phytoplanktons, that is the microscopic plants, they convert the light energy into the chemical energy. These phytoplanktons are the primary producers in a marine food chain. So these phytoplanktons are again eaten up by zooplanktons. So how to differentiate and remember these phytoplanktons and zooplanktons? Okay, zoo. We always go for a zoo to see animals. So zooplanktons means those animals which are microscopic. So they are the primary consumers in a marine food chain. These zooplanktons in turn are eaten up by smaller fish, which are the secondary consumers. These smaller fish is eaten up by again some another carnivore fish, which is a tertiary consumer. And the tertiary consumer may be eaten up by again a quaternary consumer, which is a large carnivore. So as we have studied that in each trophic level there is a progressive loss of energy. So the solar energy or the sun, so if suppose that 1000 joules of light energy is available to the plant to prepare its food and it has made its food, then what happened? It has converted from that 1000 joules. Only 100 joules is available to the primary consumer, that is the herbivore, and rest of the 900 joules energy is lost into the environment in the form of heat and respiration. This 100 joules energy which the herbivore has received, it also passes only 10 joules energy to the next trophic level, that is to the carnivore, whereas 90 joules of energy is lost to the environment as heat, as its urine, as its feces. The available energy, that is the 10 joules which is available to the lion, so it also uses only 1% to make its body mass. Rest 9 joules is lost into the environment. So dear students, don't think that only 9 joules was available. It is just to explain you that if 1000 joules of energy is available from the sun, then how much energy is available to the carnivore? It is only 1 joule which it is making its body mass. Dear students, we do not find simple food chains in an ecosystem, rather food webs are present. These food webs show the energy flow through interconnected food chains in an ecosystem. Now you see that the oak tree, it is a large producer which prepares its food material by the sun. So some leaves may fall on the ground and form the leaf litter. These leaves, they may be decomposed by the fungi or they may be eaten up by the earthworm. So here the earthworm will become the primary consumer. Similarly, the leaves of the oak tree may be eaten up by the caterpillar. The fruit or some another seeds may be eaten up by the squirrel. These squirrels may be eaten up by the fox. The shrew may be eaten up by an owl. It may be eaten up by the fox as well. The wood mouse may also be eaten up by the fox. You see that the food webs are interconnected. So as we have previously studied as well, that 10% of energy is available to the organisms to the next trophic level to make the new biomass. So these producers, when they are eaten up by the primary consumers, they receive only 10% of the energy, rest 90% of energy is lost as heat. Similarly, when these primary consumers are eaten up by secondary consumers, again they only receive 10% of energy, rest 90% is lost as heat and in undigested materials. When these secondary consumers, they are eaten up by the tertiary consumers, again 10% energy is moved to the tertiary consumer, rest 90% is lost as undigested material. So we will study about ecological pyramids. So we can compare different trophic levels in a food chain using ecological pyramids. Okay, you know that the shape of the pyramid, it's like a triangle, broader at the base, and as we move up, it becomes narrower and narrower, and at the top, it becomes a regular narrow. So there are three types of ecological pyramids: pyramid of number, pyramid of energy, and pyramid of biomass. We will study them in detail. So let's first study the pyramid of energy. The pyramid of energy shows the total energy an individual organism in the food chain of an ecosystem. That is, it tells us that how much energy is stored in the biomass of the organism at each trophic level, how much energy is there in the producers. So you see that it's broader at the base. So when these producers are eaten up by the primary consumers, energy is transferred. So lesser energy is transferred. Again, from the primary to secondary, lesser energy. So it becomes a regular pyramid, as we have studied. When we talk about pyramid of biomass, so first we see that what is biomass? It is the total mass of living matter in each trophic level at any one time in the food chain of an ecosystem. So again, it also has a regular shape. The plants, which are the producers, they are broader at the base because we see the dry mass of plants. Then these plants, they are eaten up by the primary consumers. The primary consumers, their biomass is lesser as compared to plants. These primary consumers eaten up by secondary consumers, their biomass, that is the biomass of frogs, is lesser than that of the slugs. Similarly, the biomass of the fox is also less than that of the frogs. So again, it is a regular pyramid shape. Now let's see the pyramid of numbers. It shows the total number of individuals in the food chain of an ecosystem. So we count the number of organisms, that is, we count the plants, we count the producers, which are the plants, we count the primary consumers, then we count the secondary consumers, and then we count the tertiary consumers, and then accordingly we form a pyramid. So again, it is a pyramid shape. So if everything is in pyramid shape, what is the need to study? No, dears, there are certain variations in ecological pyramids. So let's study them in detail. So dears, let's study the variations in pyramids. So first, let's see how there is inverted pyramid of numbers. So a pyramid of number does not always have a regular pyramid shape because it does not take into account the biomass of the organism. So we need to count the organisms which are present at each trophic level. For example, if we take an oak tree, so one large oak tree will become the food of many insects. So the pyramid of number will be narrower at the base and will be broader in the case of first trophic level, that is the primary consumers. So these are very small insects which suck the juice of plants. They may be eaten up by woodpecker or any other bird. So obviously the birds will require a large number of insects to feed on. So the number of woodpeckers will be smaller as compared to the insects. So again, it will become a narrower one. So let's understand the inverted pyramid of numbers by some another example. So when we found that in certain community which has some parasites, for example the ticks and mites, they are the parasites which, so when for example when we see that a red deer eats up the heather plant, so it means that more plants are eaten up by the deer. So at the base, the trophic level of the producers will be broader as compared to the reindeer, which is one in number, for example. Now on one reindeer, many ticks will be there because they have to suck the blood of the deer. So a large number of ticks will be there. So again, at secondary consumer, it will be broader. Have you thought, dears, is there an example on your body or inside your body? Yes. Suppose any one of you has had lice. So you will be a single person, and on your head there will be a lot number of head lice which will be sucking your juice, and obviously you will be eating a large number of plants, so that pyramid of number will be a little different shape. So let's see that how basically the scientists, they are counting different animals and plants. So dears, there are certain sampling techniques. The first one is the quadrat method. It's quite difficult to count all the plants in a habitat, that is, which are living in an area, so a sample is taken. So a quadrat, which is used to count the plants, so it marks off an exact area so that the plants in that area can be identified, and then it can be counted. So you can see it is a wooden frame of a specified area, and they are placed or thrown certain area, and then the scientist, they count the different types of plants and they record it. So recording or observation is very much necessary for scientists. So these quadrants should be placed randomly so that a representative sample is taken, and many quadrants should be placed so that a representative sample is taken. It means that not only one, many. If you have only one quadrant, then you will be using it at different places in a particular area. These quadrants can also be used for slow moving animals like snails and slugs. Since they are so slow moving, so we say that they are sluggish. Or if some person is very slow, we say you are so sluggish, that is, you are doing your work very slowly. Okay, so there are certain limitations of using a quadrant, because as human beings, our judgment can become an issue when we use a quadrant. Some, because as some plants may be partially inside or outside the quadrant, so there are certain basic rules that the scientists have to follow to reduce the chance of human judgment affecting the results. For sampling animals, since it is very difficult to count the animals in a particular area, larger animals and birds, they keep on moving from one place to another place, but we can count and we can get an idea of variety and number by taking samples of smaller invertebrates. So for those invertebrates, we have pitfall traps for those invertebrates, especially that are living on the ground. So as you can see in the diagram, rather a photograph, this is a trap where a beetle is moving in. Okay, so these are normally the glass containers or any other metal containers. Okay, and from the top it is covered. So spiders and slugs, they are collected in this way. The top of the container should be level with the soil trap. So there are certain rules for setting up of the pitfall trap. So the trap should also be covered with a stone or a piece of wood to keep out the rain, to make it dark, because insects, they like to live in darker areas, and obviously they are hiding themselves so that the birds do not eat them. So they should be checked on and off, because they may not be eaten up by other animals, or they may not be escape before they are counted. So like all the other different methods, a large number of traps, they make the results more reliable and minimize the effect of unusual results. There are certain indicator species which are living in a particular area. For example, lichens. So basically lichens, they are combination of fungi and alga which live in a symbiotic relationship. That is, both of different kingdoms, they live together and they benefit each other, that the fungus is giving benefit to alga and alga is giving benefit to fungus. So different types of lichens are there, like bushy lichens are there. They require a clean air. Leafy lichens, they survive a small amount of air pollution. And the crusty lichens can survive in more polluted area. So these indicator species tell us about the air pollution, and their presence or absence indicates the pollution that is present in that particular area. So dear students, I recommend you to watch the video at least 3 times.